It was cool at night, refreshingly cool, cool in the canyon. And it's also dark, almost pitch black, no lights from visible buildings. I can hear the sounds of the night, the babbling of the river, the distant sounds of cars off the highway, and other less discernible sounds. Nocturnal animals stealthily stalking their prey. It seems that today I too fall into that category. Dressed in dark clothes, I too am waiting for my prey. Strangely enough, I am overwhelmed by a feeling of quiet anger. Anger and revenge. I met Marshall Pheasant at a construction site a few years ago. I was hired to do landscaping and exterior living spaces in a new development in Forest Meadow just west of town. The entire Forest Meadow development was a magnet for Californians fleeing the collapsing state with fists full of valuable real estate. They were moving to Central Oregon. Central Oregon has the perfect climate. It doesn't rain much, but there is enough precipitation to give the mountains plenty of snow for skiers in the winter. Nearly 300 days of the year are sunny. The cold winters provide a nice change of seasons. It's not unusual to be sitting in the sun one day and snowing the next. The recreation here is superb. Powder snow for skiers, rivers, lakes, and hiking throughout the area are great for all types of outdoor recreation. There are negative sides to this migration. The main ones are rising real estate prices in Californians. I have noticed that drivers have become much ruder in a hurry. There has been a general arrogance that was rare 5, 10 years ago. Now it's here to stay. The good news is that they have the money and want everything built. To me, that outweighs the negative byproducts. When I first met Marshall, I was 28. He must have been about 10 years older. A big, charismatic guy, a little loud and generally in a good mood. On this day, he wasn't in the best of moods. He was yelling at the finished carpenter. I noticed the sloppy work when I was finishing the deck, but I didn't say anything. "This is a high-end house," Marshall shouted. "How the hell do you find this quality of work acceptable?" he continued. They went outside to my area so the carpenter could smoke. I heard the whole thing. "What are you waiting for, boy?" the carpenter replied between puffs. "This material is crap. You'll have to redo all the corners." "And it's on you! I'm not paying for the remodeling work you screwed up," growled a blushing Marshall. "To hell with it," the carpenter spat out. "I quit." He grabbed his tools and left. "Damn it," Marshall grumbled to himself. "Now what?" Then he looked at me. Then he looked at my work. All the corners were square and the spacing was just right. I'm a bit of a perfectionist, and this open living space looked great, I have to say. At this point, we started talking. He asked if I could finish the kitchen. We inspected it and familiarized ourselves with the project. Marshall pointed out places that needed fixing because of sloppy work. I saw another half dozen places that needed help too. He asked how long it would take me to finish the job. "It's estimated that I'll have 30 hours to get it right," I told Marshall. He stopped rubbing the back of his head for a moment, and I realized he was mentally calculating his blow-by-blow total. "I pay $40 an hour, and you have 25 hours to get everything done," he told me. "No thanks," I said, and gathering my tools, headed for the trailer. "Wait, wait," he called out to me. "Okay, you have 30 hours. Since this is our first job together," I said, "I'll give you my discounted rate of $60 an hour," I told him. Eventually, we agreed on 30 hours at $50 an hour. I told him I would start tomorrow. I also gave him a list of materials I needed in the morning. When we shook hands, he said, "Boy, you didn't even tell me your name," he said. "Kevin Cotton," I told him. "I'm Marshall Pheasant," he told me. "Yeah, I know. That's how we met. That first year, I was a contract laborer for Pheasant Construction. I still did some work on my own, but not as much. Marshall kept me energized. At the end of that first year, I realized something. I was making good money, there was plenty of work, but I wasn't growing my business. In a small construction business, the best way to build your brand is through word-of-mouth reputation. You do something good for someone and they tell their neighbor about it. The neighbor tells someone else. And your reputation grows. And with it, your business. I didn't get any of that. For clients, I was an employee of Pheasant Construction. The brand that was created through my work was Pheasant Construction. I called Marshall and explained my situation. Over the past year, we'd become friends. If not friends, then certainly buddies. I'd met his wife, Belinda, and I'd been to his house and sometimes had a beer after work. I told him I needed to cut my hours at Pheasant Construction. "I need to build my own business," I told him. "I like working for you, Marshall, but I need to think about my future." I could see that this shocked Marshall a little. He asked me not to make any final decisions yet. He asked me to meet him tomorrow after work at the office. The next evening at the office, I met Marshall and his older sister, Claudia Fazant Brown. I didn't know her well. She rarely spoke to me. Claudia was in finance at Pheasant Construction. She did the bookkeeping, paid the bills, collected the money, and made payroll. Marshall asked me with great officialism to sit down. He and Claudia had a proposition for me. Kevin, we want you to become a partner in Pheasant Construction, Marshall explained with a wide grin. I was a little puzzled by all of this. Partner? I asked. Yes, Claudia has all the details, he said. She can tell you the basics, and then we'll have our attorney take care of all the legal details. What do you say? He reached across the table to shake my hand and grinned broadly again. The basis was this. Marshall owned 60% of the business, Claudia owned 20%, and I owned the remaining 20%. The following Friday, we all met at the lawyer's office, and he reviewed the partnership agreement. I didn't understand everything. There were clauses about changing partnership interests, valuation depending on the business, annual meetings, subordinated loans, dividend distributions, and many other details. After a while, I didn't even try to figure it out. I just signed where I was told. During the whole process, I got the distinct impression that Claudia was angry about something. This anger seemed to be directed at me. I barely knew this woman. What could I do to her? At Pheasant Construction, a clear division of responsibilities quickly emerged. Claudia handled the accounting side of the business. I managed the field projects, often working on them myself. Marshall was in charge. He sold the work, met with vendors, communicated with developers, and built our brand. He was the face of the company. The Red Pheasant logo was clearly visible on all of our vehicles. They were easy to recognize. They were our brand. Thanks to my work and Marshall's guidance, our business grew. Although some of the work was done by subcontractors, I hired a full-time employee to help me. My coworker was a young man I had worked with before. His name was Angel Menendez. Angel was a hard worker, a quick learner, and rarely talked. I learned two things about him. One, he was married, had two young children, and was fiercely devoted to his family. Two, he was also devoted to me. Business was great. With the influx of Californians and others, our business grew. We were known as a high-quality contractor. We were able to make a profit on our work, and we shared the profits as partners. Our brand was growing, and we were making money. My life has been great professionally, but in my early 30s, I was single. Central Oregon had a lot of young, attractive women. There was a real bar scene downtown. I've been to places like that a few times. It was fun, but not really my style. I preferred to lead an active lifestyle. When I wasn't doing things in the wilderness, I was working on a small pre-war house I bought in an old neighborhood near downtown. I preferred to barbecue with friends in the backyard rather than go to the fancy bars in town. The problem was that with this lifestyle, it was hard to meet many people. Part of my workday involved picking up materials from various suppliers. Sometimes I had to pick up supplies from the big home improvement store in town. There, I happened to notice a pretty, petite, dark-haired girl working in the paint department. Every time I went there, I tried to find an excuse to flirt with her in color. I learned that her name was Tracy and that she had been working at the home center for almost a year now. I also learned that she occasionally moonlights hanging wallpaper. I told her that I could use her for one of our jobs if she was interested. She said she was interested. Another thing I noticed was the lack of wedding or engagement rings. Within a few weeks, we had become friends and chatted regularly. One day as we chatted, a large, dark-haired supervisor scolded her for not paying attention to a customer. He cast a glance at me as he walked down the aisles. Tracy seemed a little intimidated by the guy. After the client left, I asked her, "Who was that guy?" "This is Chad. He's the coordinator for my department." Saying that, she looked around to make sure he wasn't beside her. "Chad gets mad if I don't do what he wants," she said. I noticed her blush slightly after saying that. I wondered what he wanted from her. Tracy was a little cutie. She had a sort of teenage girl innocence about her. She also had a youthful, girlish voice. Was this guy really trying to get her attention? "There he is," she said and quickly stepped aside. "I'm getting off in 15 minutes. I don't want him to make me work a long shift," she said, giving me a quick, nervous smile. As I was leaving, I thought, what the hell? I'll ask her to go out to eat with me. She could always say no. It's no big deal. I retreated to the back of the store where the employee entrance is. About 20 minutes later, I saw her exit, walking briskly toward a group of parked cars. I stalked over to her and was about to call her name when Chad, the bulky store coordinator, ran up and grabbed her by the shoulder, turning the diminutive Tracy around. I couldn't make out what he was saying, but I could see it was a big, sloppy asshole trying to bully an innocent girl. When I showed up, she shook her head, saying no. Is everything okay here? I asked calmly, looking at Tracy. It's none of your business, buddy, exclaimed Chad. I looked at Tracy, and she looked scared. Are you okay? I asked Tracy. She looked fearfully at Chad and at me. She opened her mouth to speak, but no words came out. I wasn't paying attention to Chad. Suddenly, he grabs my shoulder as if to turn me away from Tracy. So here are some physical stats. By my estimate, Chad is about 6'3", 250 fairly soft pounds. One of those guys who is used to getting his way just by virtue of his scrappy physical size. On the other hand, I am 6 feet tall and weigh 180 pounds. I have to say that's a pretty solid 180 pounds. And when the asshole grabs my shoulder, I jerk my hand away, elbowing him on the forearm, still looking only at Tracy. The shrug was pure instinct. By the time I turned to look at Chad, his face had turned red and he was angry. The blow was so slow and weak that I barely had time to dodge it. My straight right to his soft gut doubled him over. I put my hand on Tracy's shoulder and pulled away. The last time I saw Chad, he was on his knees screaming about Tracy losing her job and me being charged with assault. Luckily, I noticed a security camera almost directly above us. Since he grabbed Tracy and attacked me first, none of his threats bothered me. Several things happened in a short period of time. 1. Tracy was not fired. 2. She quit and found a better job. I helped her. 3. She focused more on her business, Tracy's wallscaping. I helped here too. 4. We became a couple. In those first few weeks, I learned a lot about Tracy. Her full name is Tracy Marie Talcott. She is an only child and was raised mostly without a father. Her mom lives in Prairie View, a desert town about an hour away. Her mom is a smoker living on the edge of poverty. All of their closeness is due to the fact that they are each other's only family. They have no common interests or special affection. We were married in a small ceremony. Her mom, my family, Marshall and Belinda Pheasant, and a few others attended, and I invited Angel and Enos Menendez. Angel and I worked together every day, and a strong friendship developed between us. Life was good. Tracy and I grew close. She was very loving in every way. I taught her about outdoor recreation, fishing, hiking, mountain biking, and other fun activities we could get from living in Central Oregon. As we grew together, I learned other things about Tracy. To my surprise, she was more attracted to the nightlife downtown than I was. Every once in a while, we would stroll around town to go to a restaurant or meet friends at a bar. Tracy's eyes would light up and she always wanted to stay there as long as possible. It was even nice at first. I learned a few more things about Tracy. She was very neat and tidy in the kitchen, but her clothes were a mess in her closet and dresser. She was constantly losing her keys, her phone, her sunglasses, but would only find them a few days later. Pheasant Construction has been a thriving company. We had plenty of work and became known as high-quality builders and remodelers. Angel's carpentry skills were improving too. I was able to leave him on the job without worry. My day started with early Angel training. I would head out to one of our subcontracting crews and guide them through the process. Then I would head out to a high-precision custom job. That fall, we had a very interesting custom project in the expensive Aspen Glen neighborhood. The lot had a small arroyo or depression almost in the center of where the house would ideally stand. I suggested to the owners that they cantilever the house over the depression and let a dry creek bed run under the house. They liked the idea. Essentially, I was building a wooden bridge over an arroyo on which a house would stand. The idea was ambitious, and I had to do some research on building a bridge-like structure. Some structural design was included in the plan. Angel and I worked exclusively on it. It turned out very nicely. The home was featured in a regional consumer magazine. Pheasant Construction was named one of the most advanced and innovative builders in the Pacific Northwest. Of course, Marshall was in his element, talking about how we love pushing boundaries, creating environments, merging with nature, etc. It didn't bother me that Marshall was taking credit for Angel and my skill. I got a nice bonus, and I made sure that a good portion of my bonus went to Angel. The demand for our services increased. We were able to raise our prices, and Angel and I received bonuses for every job we did. We were also able to choose which jobs to take on. In the fall of that year, I was facing an interior remodel of an office in a large house on a piece of land west of town. It was a high-precision job with high expectations. I worked on it alone. The client's name was Preston Balfour. Balfour made his money in real estate all over the West. He had lived in Central Oregon for almost 20 years, and his home was a huge ranch west of town. He wanted a mahogany paneled study with built-in bookcases. You can imagine drinking fine cigars and brandy in such a room. Marshall told me we would make the maximum amount of money on it, but the client was very demanding. Preston liked me for some reason, and we had a drink together at the end of each day. One night he asked me some questions about my life plans and whether I had the courage to take risks. I told him I had a plan. I just hadn't worked out all the details. I don't want to do manual labor at 50, I told him. I'd like to get land outside of town where I could build a store and work on things whenever I want. He looked at me with a wide grin on his face, nodding his head and just looking at me. What? I asked. I had no idea where this was going. Son, today may be your lucky day, he told me. Preston told us that he owned several thousand acres of land on which the house we were in stood. He was on the verge of getting a county permit to build on it. His neighbor to the north, Abner Flint, was thinking of selling his 80-acre lot on which stood a small house. Are you going to buy it? I asked Preston. That old asshole hates me. He'll never sell to me. He thinks I shot one of his dogs that got on my property, he continued. Ever since then, he's been blowing me off every time he sees me. Why does he think you shot his dog? I asked. Because I did, he replied. So there you have it. That 80 acres is a gold mine once the zoning passes. Flint doesn't know anything about it yet. Son, somebody's going to make a lot of money off that land. Why not you? We discussed it, and Preston said I needed $600,000. I had an idea of how I could raise that money. I remembered that my law partnership had an equity loan option. I thanked Preston and told him I needed to think about all of this. He nodded and told me to think fast. Old man Flint's land would soon increase in value eightfold. That night I went home and told Tracy about my conversation with Preston Balfour. I'm not sure she caught all the details, but she must have sensed my excitement, and it excited her too. She also caught the idea of getting rich. The next day, I called Marshall and told him I had something I wanted to discuss with him over lunch. We agreed to meet at a cafe near the office. I considered asking Marshall to join me in the venture to purchase the Flint land. As I pondered this option, I came to a certain conclusion. Although I liked Marshall and we were partners, I couldn't say I trusted him completely. Over lunch, I told him I would like to inquire about the possibility of taking out a loan against my equity with Pheasant Construction. How much are we talking about, Kevin? Asked Marshall. Well, I was wondering if I could get $600,000, I told him. Marshall almost choked on his food. $600K, he hissed. Kevin, that's a hell of a lot of money. What are you going to do with $600K? That's where it got tricky. I didn't want to tell him what I was doing, but I didn't want to lie to him either. I was kind of mixing the truth with a lie. There's a piece of land I want to buy and eventually build a house and a store on it. It was all true. I just left out the building part. I don't know, Kevin. It seems like a lot of money for our business. I need to talk to Claudia about all of this. He wasn't optimistic. We ended up talking about business for a while. Out of the blue, Marshall invited Tracy and me to spend a week in Cabo with him and Belinda the first week of January. They had a villa for rent. We just had to pay for the flight. I told him I'd talk to Tracy. As we left, Marshall patted me on the shoulder and said with a sincere look that he would consider a loan, but not to get my hopes up. That night I was excited about the trip, but sad about the loan. Tracy was excited about the trip to Cabo and not as upset about the loan. She was already planning what she would take with her to Mexico. The next day in the middle of the afternoon, Marshall called me and asked me to come to the office after work and meet with him and Claudia. It was supposed to be about the loan. I arrived a little after 17 o'clock. Claudia greeted me and was much friendlier than usual. I wasn't often in the office, but every time I had interacted with Claudia, it had been businesslike at best, and often downright hostile. Tonight was different. How was your day, Kevin? She asked, almost affectionately. Not bad, I said, and started telling her about our projects. She nodded and smiled at me, but I was sure she wasn't paying much attention to my words. At that moment, Marshall picked up the phone, and we all walked into his office. There was a wide, charismatic grin on Marshall's face and a folder of documents on his desk. Kevin, Marshall began, Claudia and I have discussed your loan request. We take these matters very seriously. The happiness of our employees, I meant partners, is very important. I want Pheasant Construction to be more than just a workplace. I want it to be a family atmosphere. It sounded positive, almost too good to be true. Your equity is 20%. Our bank and CPA valued the business at $2.4 million. Your equity of 100% is $480,000. That's the maximum we can give you. Then he opened a file folder and handed me a check for $490,000. I've included a year-end bonus for you in the amount of $10,000. I also have a check for $5,000 for Angel. I was hoping you would present it to him. And now Claudia has brought us all some papers to sign. That was the end of the matter. I was very excited and nervous. Everything seemed to be going too smoothly. I signed a few different documents. To be honest, I didn't understand much of what I was signing. I guess I just trusted Marshall and Claudia. Marshall invited me to have dinner with him and Claudia, but I declined. "Have you bought your tickets to Cabo yet?" asked Marshall as we parted ways. I told him we'd have it done by the end of the week. I was in a good mood. My financial dreams were getting closer and closer. I loved Tracy and was making her happy with this trip. And the work was great. I loved what I was doing. I was glad Angel was doing so well, and I was feeling good about my business relationship with Pheasant Construction. What could have gone wrong? The day after working on the Preston study, we had a drink. I told him I had $490,000. "Son, you're going to need all that $600,000. Old man Flint ain't that smart, but he's stubborn. You're going to need another $110,000, he told me. For a while, we sat in silence. "What's your equity on a house in the city?" he asked. I hadn't thought of that. I originally bought the house for $175,000. With the improvements I made, it should have been worth over $300,000. "You're right," I said. "I can borrow against it and get $110,000. Or sell it and live in Flint's house while you build your store." Whatever he did, Abner Flint kept his property in good order. "Never been there, but I'll bet the house is in good condition," added Preston. I wasn't thinking about living there. My goal of owning land was suddenly fast approaching. But would Tracy like it here? I know she likes the hustle and bustle of the city, but I believe she shares my dream of land and financial independence. At least I hope so. Over the next few weeks, I contacted Abner Flint and made him a full price offer. I put my house on the market, and within 24 hours, I received several offers, all above the asking price. Tracy seemed excited, but I noticed some hesitation. All this time, I had kept my personal business separate from Pheasant Construction. During this process, I continued to seek Preston's advice. He proved to be extremely helpful. With the help of his attorney, I formalized the purchase of the land as an LLC of which I was 100% owner. I did not understand all the details of my loan through Pheasant Construction. I told Preston that I wanted to make sure that Marshall could not somehow get his hands on my land. Preston assured me that no one but me had rights to the land until I decided to sell it. On New Year's Eve, we closed on a real estate sale in Flint. Abner said he would be gone by January 2nd. Our flight to Cabo was leaving on January 5th, and we needed to vacate our house in the city by February 5th. Everything worked out just fine. On January 3rd, Tracy and I drove to the allotment. It was about 15 miles out of town. As we drove, all Tracy talked about was the trip to Mexico. She had only flown once before. We had to get an expedited passport for Tracy. She was very excited and nervous. It was an unseasonably warm January day in Central Oregon. First, we looked around the house. Preston was right. It was neat as a pin, but very dated. I enthusiastically started talking about how we could renovate it. Tracy only nodded her head, but not as enthusiastically as I was. Tropical Mexico is an overload of the senses. The warm to hot weather and gorgeous blue ocean water was breathtaking. For Tracy, who rarely traveled outside of our county, Cabo was an exotic wonderland. The few times she had been to the Oregon coast, the water temperature had never exceeded 50 degrees. The 80-degree Mexican ocean was intoxicating. The oceanfront villa was awesome, too. We had a private balcony in the bedroom and a hot tub in the bathroom. The living room had a large sun terrace overlooking the ocean. Belinda was usually on this terrace doing her sunbathing. In the mornings, we took long walks on the beach or explored downtown Cabo. One morning, we took a water cab to Lover's Beach. We saw the rugged side of the Pacific Ocean. We had been warned about the dangers of this part of the beach. About half the time, we were joined by Marshall and Belinda, but we realized we could each go about our own business. Usually by mid-afternoon, the drinks started flowing. It was paradise. Tropical drinks, beautiful ocean views, and wonderful warm weather. No stress. We all became comfortable with each other. We had spent time with Marshall and Belinda before, but when you spend a long time with someone, you can become more used to and comfortable around them. In Belinda's case, we found that she became very comfortable. Belinda was in her early 30s, I realized. Attractive and slender. She didn't have the thinness that Tracy had, but she was curvy. One evening, after a long day of beach, sun, and fun, we all probably had too much to drink. We were cooking dinner at the villa and everyone was in a good mood. Belinda asked Marshall to open a jar of salsa that was stuck. He couldn't open it. Then she asked me. I opened it. A tipsy Belinda hugged me and kissed me, thankfully on the cheek. Giggling, she staggered into the kitchen. Marshall laughed at the whole scene and then I looked at Tracy. She was staring at me and also at Belinda. I went over to hug her, but she pulled away. All that night, she was silent. I tried to pay more attention to her. Tracy, what's wrong? I asked later that night. She just shrugged and released herself from my embrace. Do you want to take a walk on the beach? I asked. It was something she liked to do when the sun was setting. She didn't answer. How about we go to bed a little early, if you know what I mean? I asked with a chuckle. No thanks, she said. I'm sure I'll be a disappointment compared to Miss Titsy, she continued. Then she walked away. What have I done? The rest of the vacation went great, and it wasn't long before we were on our way home. Back in Central Oregon, we had the added burden of packing up a house we sold in town and moving to a new place out of town in addition to our regular work. I was excited about the move, but Tracy, who had returned from vacation, looked a little depressed. We moved into the old Flint house and had some things to do. I told Tracy that we would build a new house in the next few years. The old Flint house was temporary. There were times when our goals and dreams aligned, but there were also times when Tracy said something that made me think that maybe they weren't quite the same. Suddenly, we were both busy working. As well as working part-time at Venza Paint and Tile, Tracy was also recruiting clients for Tracy's wallscaping. She was painting and wallpapering and was also quite good at Venetian plastering. Pheasant construction was thriving. By March, we were busy for most of the year, and we were picking and choosing jobs. Angel and I were mostly doing custom finishes on high-end homes. Marshall and I were discussing the possibility of hiring an in-house designer. Marshall also wanted to hire more production staff. There was still something wrong with Tracy. The transition must have taken her a while. I didn't see the happy, fun-loving Tracy as often as I used to. I kept reminding her of our long-term goals. One day in mid-spring, Tracy called me at work and asked if we could meet in town at Blacksmith's restaurant for dinner one evening. What's the occasion? I asked her. Blacksmith's was a very nice restaurant. That's on me, she said. I have something I want to talk to you about. Don't worry, I think you'll like it. But I want to talk to you about it over dinner. Good, I said. Very mysterious. She laughed and hung up the phone. That night we had a delicious dinner at Blacksmith's. All through dinner, I tried to get her to tell me what she wanted to talk to me about. Finally, as we were finishing up, she spoke nervously. Kevin, she began. You know I've always wished I had bigger breasts. I know, Tracy, but it doesn't matter to me. I like you just the way you are, I told her. You say that because you love me, but I think you'd like it. She said, I didn't say anything. I wanted to see where this was going. Yesterday, I met with a plastic surgeon, Dr. Daniel St-Pierre. Their clinic is right next to Franciscan Hospital. He said I was the perfect candidate, she said excitedly. The procedure will cost $8,000. I saved that money on my business. There are all kinds of implants, she told me. She then went on to talk about gel, silicone, and saline, the different sizes of cubes, what size would be too big, recovery time, etc. I didn't care at all. If it would make Tracy happy, I guess I'd be all for it. But I couldn't help but wonder if this whole trip to Mexico had caused her to think that way. She had surgery. It was outpatient. Dr. St-Pierre said she did wonderfully and that everything went well. For several days, she was bandaged up. Tracy took a week off work to recover. For a few weeks, she was not allowed to bend over or lift anything. Finally, one Saturday morning, I came back from working outside. I walked into the house and there stood Tracy with her new update. I was a little surprised. She looked good. She kept looking at me. She was proud of her new body and sought my approval of her improved appearance. Wow, I said, still in mild shock. Tracy, honey, you look great. She did look good, just in a different way. I guess it takes some getting used to. If Tracy was happy and it helped her come out of her dormant state, then I was happy too. Life went on. Working at Pheasant Construction was good, but so stressful. Angel and I worked hard and built beautiful structures. And we were making good money. At first, Tracy seemed happier and more confident. Her business was growing too. One night we were meeting downtown for dinner, and I was running late. I told her to get a drink and wait at the bar, and I'd be there soon. The bar faced the sidewalk, and as I walked to the door through the windows, I saw Tracy sitting behind the counter. Some handsome guy was chatting with her. No surprise, she looked good. What was surprising was the way she was playing along, almost flirting back at him. I walked in, pushed the asshole aside, and kissed her. Tracy tried to introduce me to Jackson, and I just nodded as we headed to our table for dinner. I was glad that Tracy was becoming more confident. I, on the other hand, needed to think about flirting some more. Tracy started asking me about our new house. She also started asking me about the big project that Preston had originally talked to me about. Honestly, I had been so busy at Pheasant Construction that I hadn't even thought about it. The following Sunday morning, I met with Preston Balfour for coffee. We talked about a lot of things. With Preston, he steers the conversation in the direction he wants it to go, and you just participate in the conversation. I ended up asking him about the zoning changes in the county. "Son, we have some good news and some not so good news," he said. "The good news is that all the commissioners like the idea. We'll increase the county's tax base." The bad news is one of the commissioners is resigning midterm for health reasons. The interim commissioner is a tree advocate, Margaret Plum. She was something of a hippie in her youth. She might not be as friendly to progress. We'll have to wait and see. It wasn't exactly good news. Life went on. Work was good. We were busy, making money and building some really nice things. Other parts of my life were not so positive. Obviously, the uncertain news about my land and county zoning was not what I wanted. I wanted to start building our new house, but even with the money I was making at Pheasant, I still didn't have the money to build the house I wanted for Tracy and me. Come to think of it, it looks like we were supposed to split the dividend. I'll have to remember to talk to Marshall or Claudia about the status of this issue. And then Tracy showed up. We didn't seem to be having as good a time as we used to. She was doing well, and she was becoming more and more confident. I wanted to go camping, fishing, mountain biking, or just spend time together at home. She seemed happiest when she dressed up and we went out to restaurants downtown. She had always looked good, and now, with her new physique, she was attracting a lot of attention. While I didn't doubt her fidelity, I noticed that she seemed to enjoy the attention of other men. In early September, we hired a new staff member at Pheasant. The new employee is Iris Pheasant Brown. She is Claudia's daughter and a recent college graduate. Iris has a Bachelor of Science degree in architecture. I later learned that she plans to return to college in a few years to get her master's degree. Claudia introduced us at our monthly meeting. "Kevin, I'd like you to meet my daughter, Iris Pheasant Brown." At these words, she almost bowed as if I were meeting royalty. "Hi, I'm Iris Brown." She smiled and looked me straight in the eye, extending her hand for a firm shake. So far she didn't look like her mother, and that's a good thing. We went about our usual business. We worked on the schedule a bit and talked about some upcoming construction. As I got up to leave, Claudia approached me. "Kevin, just because Iris is on staff doesn't mean you have to call for every minor issue," she said imperiously. "Mother of God!" exclaimed Iris. Iris then looked at me. "Kevin, if there is anything I can do to help, please call me anytime. I have seen some of your work and you are really good. That's one of the main reasons why I'm glad to work here," she told me. "Well, I just know you'll be busy." Claudia trailed off. Iris ignored her mother, shook my hand and said, "It's nice to meet Kevin." That was the end of it. We were still busy and the workload continued to be stressful. Angel and I were focused on quality. Marshall was focused on volume and the money it brought in. There were conflicts because of that. It was also putting stress on my relationship with Tracy and me. She was busy with her business too, but not as much as I was. I know she didn't like being home alone on weekends while I worked. In mid-October, I planned a day off. The weather this time of year can be unpredictable. It can be 70 degrees or cold. This Saturday was beautiful. Tracy was in a good mood, and so was I. Mid-morning, she came up behind me and put a blindfold on my eyes. "Leave the blindfold on, count to 200, and then find me," she whispered in my ear. I smiled as I heard the door close. I was almost to 200 when the phone rang. A customer with a problem. It was quite minor, but some of these people with money were so self-absorbed they thought the world revolved around them. He kept me on the phone for a while. After no more than 10 or 15 minutes, I calmed him down and went out. Just as I was about to go looking for Tracy, she burst into the house, crying and angry. She looked at me with eyes full of tears and locked herself in her bedroom. I was at a loss. What had I done? I was a few minutes late, but why all the tears and anger? I rang the doorbell, but there was no answer. Finally, 2 hours later, she came out, a little dressed up for Saturday. "Tracy, honey, I'm so sorry," I said. "I promised you I wouldn't work, and I got a call from some asshole client about something trivial. I promise not to work all weekend anymore." "I understand," she said. "It's okay, I overreacted." And she gave me a brief smile. I took her in my arms and hugged her. She hugged me back, perhaps with less enthusiasm. "What would you like to do this afternoon?" I asked, hoping I could salvage the weekend. "I have some errands to run in town," she said. "I won't be long." When I asked if she wanted to keep me company, she gladly but firmly declined. There was always something to do on the property, and I immersed myself in housework. Suddenly, I realized that it was late evening. It wasn't dark yet, but it was getting there. I hadn't noticed Tracy come home and hadn't heard from her. Checking the time, I saw it was 4:45. I called her, but the call went straight to voicemail. I texted her. "Hey, where are you? What are your dinner plans?" By my count, she'd been gone almost 6 hours. That's a hell of a lot to do. I kept checking for a response, but no calls or messages. I went back to the house, showered and changed my clothes, but still nothing. Now I was starting to worry that something might have happened to her. Once you run a thought like that in your brain, your imagination can run wild. I began to worry even more. After another attempt to contact her by phone failed, I decided to drive toward town and see if there had been an accident. By this time, it was already 7 o'clock and it was getting dark outside. I took the highway into town, moving slowly so I could at least make out something on the side of the road. I got to town, but I didn't find anything. I sat down for a moment to think about where she might be. As I pondered this, I realized that Tracy really didn't have any friends that I knew of. There was no one I could imagine her with. If I hadn't been so disturbed, I might have reflected on the sadness a little deeper. Finally, I drove back to our house, checking for any signs on the road along the way. I thought about calling the police, but realized she'd have to be gone a lot longer than she was now to get any results. I decided to have dinner. I cooked enough for a plate for Tracy. After that, I sipped my beer and waited. I must have fallen asleep because the next thing I knew, Tracy walked through the front door. Coming out of my evening nap, I lost my bearings for a moment. "Hi, honey, I'm home," she giggled. "What's wrong?" I asked. "I was worried about you. Are you okay?" "You didn't get my messages?" I continued. "I'm sorry, honey," and she kissed my cheek. The faint odor of alcohol? "Time got away from me," she explained with a wide smile on her face. "I've been watching her." A little unsure of her gait. Her eyes were a little glassy. It looked like she was on the road to drunkenness. "Have you been drinking?" I asked. "A little," she giggled. "I had some wine at dinner." "Tracy," I said firmly, not quite yelling, "I was worried about you. After I hadn't heard from you, I drove down the highway looking for you." "Why do you have to look for me?" she asked with an amused look of bewilderment on her face. "I was fine," she said. I got angry and the conversation went downhill from there. Eventually, I started yelling, and she didn't seem to realize what she had done wrong. She said she was shopping and decided to have dinner at Pizzazz, an Italian place in town with a small pickup bar. She said she only had 2 glasses of wine, but I doubt it was that much. Eventually, we just stopped talking to each other. I was angry, and she was angry that I was angry. She didn't understand what was bothering me or why I was angry. Furthermore, I had never seen this kind of behavior on Tracy's part. We ended up having one of those cold wars for married couples for a few days. You know how it is. You gradually start to be more civil to your spouse until you reach a normal level of affection. Despite the normalcy, I saw a side of Tracy that I hadn't encountered before, and I had some concerns. River Ridge was a new luxury development in the northwest part of the city. These were expensive luxury custom homes. Many had views, and the most exclusive ones were right on the river. Pheasant Construction started out doing a lot of work in the area. Our reputation for quality and workmanship became well known. The demand for our services was high, and some of the wealthy clients were willing to pay well for our services, and some were waiting for us to show up. It was early December, and Angel and I were trying to get our latest project in order. The porch roof needed some complicated angles to be joined. I called Iris, and she said she wanted to see it in person, so she came to the job site. She and I looked at the porch, and she brought out the plans. She detailed the roof line, and now I understood how we wanted to build this particular piece. We walked through the house together. Iris is in her early 20s. Tall, about 5 feet tall, with a pleasant appearance. Not too much makeup, but I wouldn't call her earthy. Attractive tomboyish girl? Slender, with slight feminine curves, but she didn't dress in a way that showed off that healthy body. I asked her how she liked working at Pheasant. I love it. I love the challenge of designing luxury custom homes. When I think about the other guys I went to architecture school with designing hospitals and sewage systems, it all seems so boring compared to what I do, she told me. Well, you're good at what you do and I'm glad you like it here, said I. Thank you. There are only a few things that bother me. The first is my mom, she said. Oh? I questioned, not intending to say too much about her mother. She's so meticulous about everything, getting worked up over the smallest details. And oh my God, she tries so hard to patronize me. I'm not a child, I'm a 26-year-old grown woman, she added. I didn't say anything but agreed with her comments. And the other thing is Uncle Marsh, she said. I know he's a good businessman and the company is doing well, but for him, profit is all that matters. I believe that if you create good products at a reasonable price, the money will come by itself. I just nodded. I was actually in agreement with what she was saying. Philosophically, we were in complete agreement. It would be nice to have an ally in the company. The next week, Marshall called and invited Tracy and me to return to the villa in Cabo the first week of January. By then, Angel and I would have easily finished the house in River Ridge, and this trip could be the thing that got Tracy and me back on track, and the timing was perfect. When I told Tracy about it, she was beyond thrilled. She hugged me, kissed me, and started talking about buying a new swimsuit. This revitalization in her mood lasted all through the holiday season. It was like we were back to the old days when we were so focused on each other. I decided I needed to take more vacations. The villa was just as we remembered it, and we were very happy to be in tropical Mexico. The weather was warm and beautiful, and we had a wonderful view of the blue ocean from the deck. Tracy was looking forward to wearing her new bathing suits. That first morning, we decided to take a walk on the beach. I hadn't seen any of her new suits, so I was a little shocked when she walked out onto the beach. Tracy, you're almost naked, I told her. You don't like it? She asked with a wait-and-see look on her face. No, honey, you look great, I told her. But I think others will see things in you that only I should see, I continued. I smiled slightly as I said this. I didn't want her to be upset. She looked at me, smiled, and said, That's okay, we're on vacation, I'll wear my raincoat. And we went for a walk. Soon the blanket was removed. I relaxed a little, knowing that we would never see these people again. After a while, the heat made us thirsty, and I asked Tracy if she wanted water or anything else. I walked over to one of the beach huts to get some drinks while Tracy swam in the ocean. When I returned with the drinks, I saw two young guys, fraternity members, standing next to Tracy and talking. These guys were in good shape and probably 6, 7 years younger than Tracy. When I returned, I handed her a can of Coke. The guys were polite and left pretty quickly. When I asked her what was up, she said they were just asking where she was from and how long she had lived here. I can't blame the guys, she looks incredible. What bothered me a little was how she was flirting back at them a little. We spent the afternoon on the sun deck. Marshall seemed to be paying extra attention to Tracy. It bothered me a little that Marshall had seen her like that. I know we were on vacation, and I'd certainly seen his wife topless, but Tracy was my wife, and this was somehow different. I don't know exactly why. Another thing that bothered me was that Marshall continued to pay Tracy extra attention. Tracy seemed to enjoy it, giggling at his comments. I've watched Marshall turn on the charm in business situations when he wants something. He's good at it, and he usually gets his way. I've seen something similar here in Mexico. That night after dinner, Tracy and I sat on the small balcony outside our bedroom and watched the sunset. Despite my concerns about flirting, it had been a good day. Sitting in the chair, Tracy began rubbing my shoulders and neck. After a while, she gently threw a scarf over my eyes and tied it, and I was blindfolded. After 15 pleasant minutes, the blindfold comes off and I catch a glimpse of the scene. Tracy, the palm trees swaying in the tropical evening, and was there movement from Marshall's balcony? At the end of the week, Marshall and I broke protocol and discussed business. We could now in good conscience write off most of the trip. Marshall thinks we need to hire some more carpenters. Kevin, our brand is at its peak right now. Our plans are already scheduled many months in advance. We have verbal commitments for 4 more homes in River Ridge. I'd like to finish all 4 this year, he said. This year, exclaimed I. Angel and I will start Juniper 552 after we get back, and we'll be lucky if we finish another big novel this year. There's no way we can even finish 3. Isn't the one on Canyon custom made? I asked. Yes, the bridge, he said. Kevin, listen, I have a plan. A guy I play golf with, my own brother, is moving to Central Oregon in February. I talked to him on the phone. He's a construction worker. The guy seems to know what he's doing and has a crew. Apparently, he's been building houses in Houston for a long time. Don't worry, you're still in charge. He will report to you. I see you and Angel are taking care of 2 houses, and the new guys are taking care of the other 2. He smiled and patted my shoulder. Great, I thought. We have a high-end brand to protect. And now I'm responsible for these new guys whose skills I have no idea whatsoever. I'm already feeling the stress and the strain. All too soon, we were back in Central Oregon. Tracy seemed to carry Cabo's good mood home into our lives after vacation. It was a positive thing. Angel and I got busy with the house on Juniper Drive in River Ridge. I knew I was going to be busy this year. I promised myself that I would carve out time for Tracy and me in this busy year. The funny thing was that Tracy showed up less often than usual. Every week or two, she came home in the middle of the evening, after dinner. Even on some weekends, she was gone for long periods of time. When I asked her about it, she said that her business was really picking up. The positive attitude persisted, and that was a good thing. This was the new confident Tracy. One day, Marshall called out of the blue and asked if I could meet him at his office after work. When I pulled up, I heard some voices coming from Marshall's office, and Iris looked at me strangely, rolling her eyes. I walked in. "Kevin, glad you could make it," Marshall said enthusiastically. "I'd like you to meet our new employees," he continued. "Kevin, this is Terry Destry, Junior Messersmith, and Ed Crump." Silently shaking their hands, I looked around the group. Destry looked like a chieftain. Skinny, lupine, skin tight, with a permanent smirk on his face and half-closed eyes. I had a distinct feeling I wasn't going to like this guy. Messersmith weighed 300 pounds, fat but stout, with a shaved head. He didn't look particularly intelligent either. Krampus was small and squinted, his eyes dancing. He kept glancing at Destry, assessing his facial expression before reacting to anything. Puppet. I really hope my initial reaction to this group was wrong. "Let's have a drink around the corner, get to know each other, and make a tentative plan," said Marshall, and I saw him pat Destry and Crump on the back as we left the office. I wanted to find out how much Destry knew about construction. I asked him about this or that construction technique, and he claimed to know it. To all my questions, he answered briefly and affirmatively. Every now and then I would say something, and Destry and Crump would giggle, as if I were some dumbass who didn't understand their inside joke. At one point, I looked over and saw Marshall talking to Junior about his vision for Pheasant Construction and long-term growth plans, the brand, our goals. Junior was looking at him with a completely blank expression on his face. Marshall might as well have been talking to a stone Buddha. The next day, I met Angel, and as soon as we agreed, I went to see how Destry and company were doing. I drove up to their construction site, and there was nobody working. Destry and Krampus are smoking, and Junior's eating a donut. "Is the guy on a break?" I ask. "I don't have any plans, boss," Destry tells me. "You're the project manager, and I expect you to be on the construction site giving us orders," he says with a challenge in his voice and a smirk on his face. I took a long, hard look at him, shook my head, and outlined my schedule for the day. From what he'd told me last night, this assembly shouldn't be a problem for his skills. As soon as they got to work, I went back to Juniper to work with Angel. By the end of the day, I was back at Destry's place of work. They had some skills and had made some progress, but it wasn't the same quality that Angel and I had. I didn't see anything in particular that they were doing wrong. Just some carelessness and underhandedness that I wouldn't do. Now I was used to going to Destry's office first, making sure they had a plan for the day, and then going to Angel's office. By the end of the day, I would map out the next day's plan with Angel. Angel was so good, I almost didn't need to do that. Life with Tracy was good, but changing. As I said, she was more confident and dressed in a way that showed off her body more. Her appetite for the restaurants, bars, and stores in town seemed to have increased. One evening, we met for dinner at Pizza's restaurant. We talked about how our day had gone. I noticed that while I was talking to Tracy, every now and then her eyes would scan the room to see who was here and what she was doing. I felt like I wasn't getting her full attention. We were talking about our new house, and she was asking about land, development, and the neighborhood. I thought I needed to talk to Preston about it again. I told her that I believe we are close to starting construction on the new house. I also told her that Iris was doing the design. As I started to give her some details, she looked at me over her shoulder, and her face lit up with a wide smile. I feel a pat on the back and unmistakably recognize Marshall's greeting. "What a pleasant surprise to meet you both here," he muttered. "Kevin," he greets me with a quick squeeze of his shoulders. "And the lovely Miss Tracy," he says, and puts his arm around her. As they separate, I notice her quickly scrutinizing her cleavage. Since when did these two develop such a friendship? I know we all hung out together in Cabo, but that was almost 3 months ago. They look like old friends or more. And Tracy is just glowing looking at Marshall. "Would you like to join us?" asks Tracy. "Just a minute, I'm meeting some people at the bar." He takes a vacant chair, pulls himself over to Tracy, and starts talking. This goes on for about 15 minutes before he leaves to meet with his people. During this time, I estimate that at least 12 of those minutes were completely focused on Tracy. He told her more than once how beautiful she looked. Each time she smiled broadly in appreciation. There was a strange atmosphere emanating from this whole scene that I didn't like. On the way home, I reminded Tracy that my land deal was not something I wanted Marshall to know about. All the way there, she was uncharacteristically quiet, silently staring out the window into the night. Sunday morning, I went over to Preston's for coffee. He was always happy to see me. I considered Preston a good friend, and he seemed to like me too. From time to time, I asked Preston for advice, and so far, he had always been helpful. We talked a little about Pheasant, and I told him about Destry and the Texas crowd. I also told him my thoughts on Marshall. "Son, have you ever thought about going off on your own?" he asked. I told him that up until the last few months, I really enjoyed my job at Pheasant. I told him that Marshall was really good at what he did, and that I thought we were really building something in this business. "I was hoping it would happen," I said. "Once the county approves the development, I'll have enough reserves to start my own business. Build one house a year, and focus on building a high-quality product." "Ah, yes, the county." Preston sighed and looked up at the ceiling as if asking for divine help. Margaret Plum, the hippie woman, as we expected, is slowing down the process. The other two commissioners are ready to go. "Just last week, I submitted a new proposal to them." "What's the new offer?" I asked. "The minimum lot size is 5 acres," he said. "That means there will be fewer houses, less traffic, less pollution, and a smaller carbon footprint. I hope that will be enough to sway Margaret. He told me not to worry about getting a great return on my investment and to be patient." I was pleased with this because, as I said, so far Preston had always given reliable advice. I thanked him, and as I was leaving, I asked him again about my legal defense with the LLC his attorney had set up for me. "Don't worry, son, no one can have this land but you. Not even your sweet little bride," he told me. I thought about that as I drove home. In midsummer, Angel and I finished the house on Juniper Drive and began construction on another large house in River Ridge. Destry and Company had stalled building the house due to quality issues. The owners were not satisfied with several things about their workmanship. Marshall called and suggested that I send Angel over to help them finish up so we could complete this project. When I told Angel about it, I realized he wasn't thrilled about working with the Destry boys. On the evening of the third day of Angel's work with Destry, Angel called me. "Casey, I don't want to work with these guys anymore," Angel said. I didn't blame him, but I wanted to know why. "How come, Angel?" I asked. "I just don't want to work with them. I work with you or myself, not with them," he said. I asked him to elaborate, but he didn't want to say anything, so I finally got him to tell me. "They laugh at me, call me names, bad guys. I don't want to leave you, but I don't work with them anymore," Angel told me. "Goddamn assholes!" I saw it happen. I should have thought about it. I felt sorry for Angel. "No, Angel, you're not leaving. You don't have to work with them anymore," I told him. "You're coming back to me starting tomorrow. I'll take care of it." "Gracias, Casey," he said to me. The next morning, I arrived at their house early. "Where's Jose?" asked Destry. I didn't say a word, just went nose to nose with him and stared. "If you bloody idiots knew how to build properly, he wouldn't be here," I told Destry firmly, looking him straight in the eye. "Easy, boss. Get out of my space." He said it without a cocky smirk. As the tension was building, Junior came over. I thought about it. I didn't want to mess with that monster. I stepped aside toward the house to reduce the tension a bit. "Just do your job right if you want to keep working here," I said. "Are you threatening us with our jobs, boss?" asked Destry. "Just manage your projects from now on," I said, walking back to my truck. I heard Destry say something, but I wasn't quite sure what it was, and then I heard Krampus start cackling. It sounded like, "You can't even handle your woman." Maybe that's what I heard? That day I thought about Tracy while I was working. She was in a good mood most of the time, but I'm not sure I was the one who put her in a good mood. She was away a lot, sometimes all the way into the evening. Sometimes she'd come home after 9 o'clock at night. When I asked her questions, she gave vague answers. I know she worked hard, just like me. We used to talk about our dreams and goals when we were together. However, lately it seemed like I was doing most of the talking and she was just agreeing with me. It seemed like we were drifting apart. That night I told her all of this without accusation. I got her attention, and over the next few months things went back to normal. We spent more time together, and she was in a good mood most of the time. Far fewer evenings out. We were still a little out of sorts, but I attributed that to our frantic work schedules. I met with Iris several times a month, mostly at our construction site, so she could update me on progress, answer questions, and make sure everything was on track. To supplement her income, Iris told me she works as a bartender at Maxine's, a nice restaurant near the center of town. My uncle doesn't pay that much, but it's even fun. On weekends, I can easily make between $100 and $200 a night. Iris asked me to go with her when she was at Destry's work. He gives me the creeps, she told me. And that younger one. He looks at me like he's going to rape me at any moment. She wasn't kidding. One day in early November, as she was leaving our construction site, she asked me a strange question. Are you and Tracy all right? She asked. Yeah, why? I asked. Okay, she said. Forget I asked. And with that, she left. I wonder why she asked. Tracy and I seemed to get along just fine. The pressure to complete these jobs was immense. The pressure came not only from the customers, who had their own deadlines, but also from Marshall. The more production he received, the more money Pheasant Construction made. My pressure was compounded by a desire to create a good product and make sure Pheasant Construction's reputation was not damaged. After all, I was a partner. In late November, I told Tracy that the next month or so would be busier than usual. She took it calmly. The next day, Marshall called and invited us back to Cabo in January. Marshall, how can you even offer Cabo this year? I asked him. We're a few weeks behind, and the homeowners are supposed to move in by mid-January. Kevin, you're the project manager. It's your job to get projects done on time. I plan to go, and I want you and Tracy to go. He spoke very calmly. I was furious. How could he in good conscience take a vacation when I was working 60-plus hours a week? Well, I can't go. Maybe Tracy and I will take a vacation when things are settled. The other thing is that I'm spending so much time fixing your boy Destry's mistakes that it's slowing me down. We're going to have a serious discussion about all of this as soon as I can finish the project. I told him. A few days later, I got a call from Tracy. Why didn't you tell me we were invited back to Cabo? She asked. Apparently she'd run into Marshall somewhere, and he'd said something. Tracy, that didn't make sense. There's no way I can get away from the job I'm working on right now. Even without a vacation, it's going to take all my time to finish it by the 15th, I told her. And that was the end of it. I knew she was disappointed, but there were no options. Destry and his crew were running out of time on the Canyon Ridge house. I expected Tracy to be upset about Cabo, but at home that evening, she was in a great mood. Perhaps she is beginning to realize that in a few months, maybe months, but no more than a few years, our life's dream will be fulfilled. Fewer hours, less financial stress, and more time to do the things we want to do. That Saturday, Tracy had planned a date night for us. Dinner in town, followed by a nice evening at home. We had a nice dinner, and as we sipped our wine, Tracy, a little nervously, started talking. Kevin, honey, I know you're very busy right now and don't have a lot of free time. But you see, the thing is, I'm starting to slow down for winter, she told me. Okay, I knew all that, but what's the point of all this? And even though you can't go, I bought a ticket for me to Cabo. At those words, she lowered her face and looked up quickly to gauge my reaction. Are you going without me? I asked. It's only for a few days, and I really love being there, in this beautiful villa and in this fantastic weather. They said it's okay if I come alone, she said. I didn't say a word. Several thoughts ran through my head. The first was Tracy walking around topless when I wasn't around. But what bothered me most was the lack of self-sacrifice on her part. I thought she and I had a dream, a vision of what our lives would be like. To achieve our dreams, we often have to make sacrifices. I worked hard. That was a sacrifice. There was no way I could take a vacation. That was a sacrifice. I had to deal with assholes like Destry. That was a sacrifice, too. I hadn't seen much sacrifice from her, and now she was planning to go to Cabo without me. It was so wrong that for the first time I began to doubt her loyalty to me. Along with that, I began to question my loyalty to her. Okay, looks like you've already made up your mind, I said. You mean I can go? She asked. It was like communicating with a child. Tracy, you're an adult. You can make your own decisions. I have to say I'm surprised and disappointed, I said. I know, she said. I'm disappointed too. She didn't understand my disappointment at all. She thought I was disappointed that I couldn't go. Of course, I meant disappointed in her decision to do it without me. As we walked to my car, she hugged my arm, satisfied that she'd gotten her way. I wasn't happy at all. She chatted all the way home. I had nothing to say. Once home, she tried to initiate sex. Not today, Tracy, I said. It's been a long week. In all the years we'd been together, I'm not sure I'd ever turned her down for sex. She just looked at me in surprise. You don't want me? She asked, completely discouraged. I told her not today. She still hadn't realized that I was disappointed in her because of that trip to Cabo. In the weeks leading up to the trip, there were times when our communication was pretty good. But I was working so many hours, and most of the time I didn't have the energy to pretend that everything was okay. The day she left, I told her to have a good time and that she and I would have some things to discuss after she returned. "What kind of discussion?" she asked. She had a slightly concerned look on her face. "Have a good time and then we'll talk about it," I told her. Was it cruel to bring it down on her right as she was leaving? Did I want it to stay on her mind while she was on vacation? Did I want her to be unsure of my commitment to her? Absolutely. The week flew by quickly. I was able to work long hours and we ended up finishing the house ahead of schedule a few days before the owners were supposed to move in. I told Preston about some of the things going on in my life and he helped me make a plan for this year. I knew things would be different this year, I just didn't know how much. But I'll find out soon enough. Also, Preston told me he's gotten some positive signals from the county and may have some good news soon. When Tracy came home, I noticed something had changed. She seemed more distant, less involved in our relationship. Sometimes I caught her talking quietly on her cell phone, ostensibly on business. I called Marshall and set up a meeting for Friday after work. He asked what the purpose of the meeting was, and I said, "Lots of things." When Marshall, Claudia, and I gathered in the office, I told them I wanted to discuss the upcoming year and some changes that needed to be made. First of all, the schedule we had last year can't continue. Angel and I are working too many hours. I know we get paid well, but this is too much, I told them. "I'm sure we can work it out, maybe even hire someone else," said Marshall, not giving the appearance that he cared much about the subject. "Well, speaking of staff, I won't be working with Destry and his crowd this year. I won't be managing his projects, and Angel and I won't be fixing his blunders. Not anymore." I kind of raised my voice as I said it. Suddenly, I had Marshall's attention. "Wait a minute," he said, becoming a little more serious. "It may have taken Terry and his team a few months to realize how we work, but we're not going to get rid of them. They're too valuable." "Fine, you can keep them," said I. "Neither Angel nor I will have anything to do with them," I told them. "Wait," he said. "Angel is an employee of Pheasant Construction, and if he's assigned to work with them, he'll work with them." Marshall's voice was rising. "Furthermore, if I assign you to work with Terry or Junior or anyone else, you will work with them." Now he was yelling at me. "You're forgetting, Marshall, that I'm a partner too," I said. "I have rights as an owner, and I'm exercising my rights in this matter." After saying that, I saw Marshall look at Claudia, and she quickly looked away. There was a pause in the discussion. "What?" I asked. They looked at each other again, and then I saw Claudia nod toward Marshall. "Kevin, you're not a partner anymore," said Marshall to me. He further told me that when I took out the loan, it was secured by my stock. According to the corporate charter, I had to start paying off the loan. As I repaid the loan, I would get my shares back. "I explained it to you during the loan processing," Claudia told me. I never brought up this discussion. No wonder they were so willing to extend credit. I'd been busting my ass at Pheasant Construction for the last 2 years, thinking I owned it, but I was no different than Junior or Crump, just an hourly employee. "I see," I said, standing up. I was so angry that I needed to leave. I was afraid of what I might do. "Kevin, we can certainly continue to discuss some of these issues," Marshall was saying as I left the office. "Kevin," Iris called out to me as I was leaving, but I didn't believe myself that I could say a word to her. That night, I really wanted to discuss the future with Tracy. I hoped that she would be there for me during this difficult time and that we could plan our future. By 7 o'clock, she still wasn't home. She hadn't answered her voicemail or texts. I needed to find out. I'd planned to talk to Angel, I owed him. But I was sure my days at the Pheasant were over. All my trust in Marshall was gone. Claudia came up with a plan to get me removed as partner. Meanwhile, I was working 50, 60 hours or more each week. All of my efforts and stress were making Pheasant Construction's reputation worse and worse. Tracy finally showed up a little after 9. I was confused. I wanted to talk to her about everything, but at the same time, I was annoyed that she had come so late and hadn't told me anything. When I asked her where she was, she became defensive and never gave me an intelligible answer. The mood between us was not good at that moment. I could not envision a scenario in which I could get the support I needed to discuss the future. I went to bed upset with Tracy, and she didn't talk to me either. The next day, I went to see Angel. He was the one I was most worried about. If I left, would he be able to continue working at Pheasant with Destry's attitude toward him? I sat down with Angel and explained that I was leaving and why. He nodded and understood. I asked him if he would be okay, and he said he would be. He was a tough kid. He then asked what I was going to do. "You know, Angel, I'm going to start my own carpentry business. It's going to take some time to get it up and running. But I'm sure I can succeed at it," I told him. "And I can't do it right away. but if you can hold out for a few months, I'd love for us to work together again, said I. He smiled and said he wanted that too. You'll tell me when you're ready to receive me, KC, he told me. I hugged him as I left. It had gone better than I had expected. I had quite a bit of cash on hand that I was going to spend on financing my new house. So cash flow wasn't going to be a problem. I'll just wait a few more months before I start setting up my new place. Now I had to quit Pheasant Construction. I called Marshall on Sunday. I was ready to leave him a voicemail, but he surprised me by answering. Kevin, I'm so glad you called. I hadn't even spoken yet. I know we had some disagreements on Friday, but everything can be worked out. He continued in his most convincing voice. When I finally got a chance to talk to Marshall, I just said, Marshall, I'm resigning immediately. That's all I had to say. Kevin, you're not resigning. He said it in his most confident voice. You and I are going to sit down and work this out. Where are you? Let's have lunch and work it out, he continued. Marshall, I'm done. I'll never work with you again, I told him. And then he went on to talk about how we had a backlog of work that needed to be done. How could I leave our company after all these years? His outrage was unbounded. Then, just to tease, I said, Marshall, I'm sure Terry Destry and his team, for all their skill, can easily handle all the work. After all, just a few days ago you were telling me how good they are. Didn't you? I couldn't help myself. I was still so angry at this guy. There was a pause on the line as if we were digesting what I had said and my sarcasm. You son of a bitch, he hissed at me. After everything I've done for you, you'll never get a job in this town again. Hell, you can't even satisfy your woman. He said this with a sarcastic grin. I hung up. My woman? What was that? Why had he dragged Tracy into this? Did something happen in Cabo with Tracy? I needed to find out. A strange coincidence occurred when I was on my way home. As I drove past a popular cafe, I saw Belinda Fissan's car parked out front. She drives a white BMW X1 with license plates. Belinda. I pulled over. Maybe she could tell me what might have happened in Cabo. I saw Belinda sitting alone, fiddling with her iPhone. I sat down across from her. I think I startled her with my suddenness. Jesus, Kevin. What the hell are you doing here? She asked me without much friendliness or warmth. I was surprised to see that it was as pale as I was. Even after a week or so, one would expect some of the bronze to remain. Belinda, can I ask you a couple questions? She just looked at me. I took that as a yes. Did you go to Cabo this year with Marshall? Do I look like I've been to Cabo? She asked, throwing her hands up to demonstrate the pallor of her skin. I sat stunned, digesting the meaning of what was being said. I left Marshall in November. I live in one of the condos in Forest Meadow, she told me. And I think your little wifey has something to do with it, she continued. I never caught them, but she was around a lot. He said he was helping her with the business. I think he was helping her, but business had nothing to do with it, she said. So, wait a minute. You're saying you saw Tracy and Marshall together? I asked. Together! Yeah, a lot. It started sometime last year when I started noticing her hanging around somewhere. Before I left him, my spies told me they saw them together all the time at bars and restaurants. And even when I didn't hear from them, he often didn't come home until the evening. She continued. A couple of times I was told that his car was parked outside some of the houses that Pheasant was building after hours. When you drive a big white Suburban with red Pheasant logos, it's very difficult to get in unnoticed, she told me. I just sat there stunned. All those late nights, the mysterious phone calls, the time away from home, and then all those comments from everyone. I must be the only idiot who didn't realize what was going on. I got up to leave without saying a word. My thoughts were a blur. You're not still with her, are you?
What?
She called out to me as I left. As I left, I quietly said to myself, No, probably not. On the way home, I struggled with my emotions. I was so sad and betrayed by my wife and former business partner employer. How could they do this to me? But during the trip, my emotions began to change, from sadness to anger. Anger partly at Tracy, but mostly at Marshall. When I thought of Tracy, one thing I liked about her was her simple, trusting innocence. One thing I kept noticing about Marshall was his persuasive, manipulative personality. Tracy never stood a chance. I know that doesn't excuse her behavior, but it goes a long way toward explaining it. When I got home, the Corolla was in the driveway. All right, let's settle this, I thought. When I walked in, Tracy was sitting there, professionally dressed, hair combed, makeup applied. She stared at me with a guilty expression on her face. Who went to Cabo? I asked, trying to remain calm. She stared at me, then looked away sharply, then lowered her eyes. Eventually, she told me it was just her and Marshall. She admitted to having sex with him at the villa in Cabo. When I asked if they had been intimate before Cabo, she said, maybe 2 or 3 times. I realized it was more like 10 or 20. I exploded and started yelling at her. She was crying and kept apologizing. I stopped bullying her and asked her why. He told me he loved me, she sobbed. Truth be told, it hurt, but not as much as I thought it would. Ever since she'd told me she was going to Cabo without me, I'd been subconsciously planning an exit strategy. Many people will ask, why did I let her go? Why didn't I drop everything and go too? Why didn't I fight for her? The answer is somewhere along the line. Deep down, I knew it wasn't going to work. In a weird way, I even sympathize with Tracy. Maybe I was forcing a lifestyle on her that she didn't want. She said she was going to Marshall's, and I left for a walk around the grounds. I told her I'd be back in half an hour and that I'd look forward to her absence. I refused to give her a goodbye hug. When I reflected on my life, I thought I had it all. A beautiful wife, a partnership in a growing business, a career I was good at and enjoyed, business partners I could work with, and finally the opportunity to become financially independent because of the land I owned. Now all I had was land, and that wasn't for sure. Like I said, I was saddened by the loss, but most of all, I was angry at Marshall for ruining everything. I blamed him. For the next 4-5 weeks, I didn't get much done. I drank a lot and felt sorry for myself. I didn't exercise. I lived a sloppy lifestyle. I didn't hear from Tracy or Marshall, and I didn't want to. I didn't feel comfortable. Every once in a while, I would get a message from Iris just checking in on me, and I appreciated it. I was sitting there late one Friday night trying to work on my business plan, and then Iris called. She said she had a new concept for my house. Suddenly, I felt excited and motivated. I wanted to see her new plans. Maybe I could even get started on them, I thought. She said she works at Maxine's, but she had plans with me. I told her I would meet her at Maxine's. Kevin, can you drive? She asked. I'm fine, I told her. I've only had one drink. Well, maybe 2 or 3. I need to be more careful driving. About halfway to town, I took stock of the situation. I probably should have cleaned up a little before I went to Maxine's. I was in sweatpants, work boots, and a long-sleeve t-shirt. I hadn't shaved in a few days and probably needed a shower. Not the best image of a typical Maxine's customer. Maxine's has a beautiful wood-paneled bar. It's not a place for a pick-me-up, more like a celebration or romantic dinner. It's not usual to see people in jackets and ties or dresses for the ladies. It's not dark, but there is mood lighting for a martini or glass of Pinot Noir. I was a little ashamed of my scruffy appearance and apologized to Iris for it. She watched me carefully and said, "Don't worry about it. We're not too busy yet. But you could definitely use some tidying up." I asked her for the plans, and when she gave them to me, I got up to leave. "Kevin, stay a minute. I'm slow right now. Take a look and tell me what you think of the house," she said. "Let me get you a cup of coffee." "I can stay for a few minutes. How about a whiskey and soda?" I asked. She looked at me silently for a long time but brought me my drink. She had a customer at the other end of the bar and went out to help him. As I sipped my drink and considered her plans, I heard the door open and saw Iris look up anxiously. Then I heard it. It was Marshall, Destry, and 2 other cowboys. He saw me right away and the group walked over to him. What the hell were they doing at Maxine's? I saw Iris watching anxiously. "Well, well, if it isn't good old Kevin," he said. "What's up, buddy?" he said, and looked me over from head to toe with a wide grin on his face. I didn't say a word. "A little celebration for our company," he continued. "This week we signed contracts for 3 new homes in River Ridge. Business, as they say, is booming." He laughed. "You seem a little out of sorts, Kevin. Are you okay?" he asked with mocking sincerity. Krampus and Destry chuckled. I said to Iris, "I gotta go. I'll talk to you later," ignoring Marshall and his crowd. When I got up, Marshall stood right in my space and said, "I'll tell Tracy I saw you. She's home right now waiting for me." With a knowing smile, he threw that in my face. This elicited another laugh from the group. I think it was a combination of my hatred for Marshall, humiliation in front of the 3 scumbags, and disrespect for Tracy. I punched him in the face, knocking him to the ground. Junior quickly grabs me from behind, clasping my hands, and then Destry appears. He slaps me, backhanded, right to left, right to left, right to left. When Marshall gets up, he yells to his guys, "Press his hands against the bar!" Junior holds me, Destry grabbing one arm and Krampus the other. Junior squeezes me, and I can barely move, my hands on the bar. "Sister Joan taught me a lesson in Catholic school. Swollen knuckles teach lessons, Marshall hissed at me. And with those words, he brought the bottle of beer down on my left hand. I had the strength to move it, but it still caught a lot of it, and it hurt. At that moment, Iris and a couple of waiters jumped up to us. Get out of here, she yells. For a moment, I think she's addressing me, but no, she's looking at Marshall and the others. Junior lets go of me with a shove, and they walk quickly and silently to the door. She looks at me and tells me to sit at a small table by the door to the kitchen, away from the other customers. Back at the bar, things quickly return to normal. I am completely and utterly humiliated, and my arm is in great pain. One of the waiters brings me ice. Getting an insult from Marshall, cracked knuckles, and then a slap from Destry was humiliating. On top of that, I looked at myself. I looked pathetic. Unshaven, in sloppy clothes, with a bleeding arm and half drunk. Embarrassing. Iris comes up. I'll give you a ride. I start to protest and she tells me, You've been drinking. You're in pain and you're emotional. Don't even think about it. She looks at me with a long, hard stare. Shortly after, I see none other than Preston Balfour enter Maxine's. I see Iris point to the corner I'm in, and he walks over. Come on, son, he says to me, and we walk out. A silent ride home. Now I'm ashamed of Preston, too. I feel like I've really hit rock bottom. We stopped, and he said, Get cleaned up, and I'll see you in the morning. It's Saturday morning, and Preston shows up around 7:30. Fortunately, I had already showered, shaved, and dressed. We have a long conversation, first about life in general, but gradually we start talking about my life, some of my mistakes, and then the future. Son, I'm going to tell you something someone once told me. He pauses and sighs deeply. You see, I used to love to play cards. To tell you the truth, I wasn't very good at it. One night I lost all my rent and food money for the month. I sat on the front steps and felt sorry for myself. Then this old man sat down on the steps next to me. I began to tell him how unlucky I was and how I was always getting bad cards. Partner, he says to me, there's one thing you have to remember about cards. We can't control the cards we get. But when they are dealt to us, it's our job to play them the best way we can. When he got up to leave, he said, That's for life too, and walked away. I never forgot that advice and never gambled again. After a while, Preston left, but I haven't forgotten his words. The situation was gradually improving. I began to take care of myself first and foremost. I finished my business plan. I vowed to give up alcohol, and I mostly kept to myself. Once or twice a week, I would get texts and calls from Iris, and I would talk to Preston. He helped me register my business, KC Custom Carpentry, as an LLC. My anger at Tracy was replaced by sadness about what we had and what was gone. I was sad that we weren't together, and about the life path she might choose. Poor naive Tracy, seduced by that sociopath. My anger at Marshall burned bright and hot. Only I hadn't figured out how to get my revenge yet. One evening, Preston called and invited me over to his place. We gathered in his office, which I built, and I noticed an open bottle of champagne. Are we celebrating? I asked as he poured me a glass of bubbly. Yes, as a matter of fact, it is, he said. My friend at the county commission said they voted to extend the zoning to R5. All of your property and most of mine will get that zoning on June 1st. We raised toasts and talked about what it all meant. It was a happy conversation. After all, I was going to be rich, or at least comfortable. We also talked about my life and the twists and turns it has taken in the last year or so. I was spouting off and Preston was just listening. Eventually, I started talking about Marshall and what a bad person he was. As I was about to leave, I hugged Preston, thanked him, and told him what a good friend he was. He just nodded his thanks. He stood on the porch as I walked to my car. From the porch, he said, Son, you know something has to be done about him. Who? I asked. You know who, he said, turned and walked into the house. 3 days later, I got an unexpected phone call. I'm looking for a custom home in the River Ridge neighborhood. I was given your name, he said. He introduced himself as Fairchild Reese. We agreed to meet on his land the next day. We ended up looking at the site and I put together my proposal. I had a good markup, but I really wanted to do this project. I presented a proposal, we haggled, and came to an agreement. I later learned that he had originally signed with Pheasant, but declined after seeing some of their recent work. I have a strong suspicion that this recommendation came from Iris, but she won't admit it. I called Angel to discuss the possibility. We agreed to meet at the River Ridge construction site on Saturday morning. We looked at the site and familiarized ourselves with the plans. Angel asked a couple questions and gave us some ideas about the construction. Everything he said made sense. I told him that the Reeses had money, that they were special, but seemed reasonable. Finally, I asked Angel, "So, are you ready to leave Pheasant and work with me?" He looked at me, lowered his eyes, thought for a minute, and agreed. I hugged Angel, so glad to be working with him again. "KC, I need you to look at something," says Angel to me. There seems to be some hesitation on Angel's part about the current construction of the Pheasant at River Ridge. The site spans the canyon, and the plan was to build a bridge connecting the sites on both the east and west sides of the canyon. Destry and his crew were building a bridge. Angel was in the process of finishing the house to bring it up to code. When he saw the bridge, he had some doubts. When he tried to ask Destry about it, he was told to shut up and mind his own business. I asked if Marshall or Destry would be at the construction site today. Angel told me, "No way. I guess you can never confuse this group for workaholics." We went to the job site. It wasn't that far from the Reese's lot, maybe 3/4 of a mile. As Angel said, there was no one there. We walked up to the bridge. There was a small shelf about 4 feet from the edge of the canyon. The full depth of the canyon was 40 or 50 feet. Angel led me over to a shelf so we could look at the bridge structure from the underside. "KS, look." He pointed to the joints. "Screws only, no metal plates. They'll break and that bridge will kill someone," Angel told me with deep concern. He was right. That bridge wouldn't pass any inspection. The entire structure was compromised. The county was so far behind in building inspections that it would be months before anyone saw it. When I looked at the structure, it looked like typical Destry work. Low quality, just enough to get by. Enough to survive the first warranty year. Certainly not designed for the long term. "Angel, forget it, let's go," said I. "Casey?" he asked, looking at me with concern. I told him we had to leave. I also told him to quit Pheasant immediately and never come back to that construction site again. I started thinking about a few things. 2 days later, I got a call. The caller ID said Tracy. I almost didn't answer. "Hey, how's it going?" I asked. In a quiet voice, I heard, "Kevin, I think I'm in trouble." "Can you meet me?" she said. "Where's Marshall?" Unable to resist, I asked her. Then she started sobbing. "Kevin, please!" she gasped. I met her in town, and she told me she was scared. Scared of what she had gotten herself into. When I asked her to explain, she said it was a long story and she didn't want to stay in town. Someone might see her. I told her to follow me to my house, our old place. On the way, I made a phone call. When we arrived, I told her to pull the car behind the old store out of sight. We entered the house and I asked Tracy to tell me what was going on. She was visibly upset and trembling. She told me the following. Marshall was charming at first. Took her out to dinner, bought her clothes, treating her well. I hated to hear it, but at the same time I was perversely curious, wanting to know the whole story. Seems like things started to change after her last trip to Cabo. She was no longer respected. He didn't ask her out as often. He was just waiting for satisfaction for himself. According to her, she didn't understand what was going on. Marshall told her he loved her. And last night, Marshall took her out to a nice dinner, turned on the charm, and asked her if she loved him. She said she did. He told her that he was having problems at work and needed her help. She told him she was willing to help in any way she could. He told her that Destry and his boys were going back to Texas and he needed them to stay. He had a lot of things piling up. She just looked at him, wondering how she could help. He told her that if she was friendly with them, they would stay at the Pheasant. At first, she didn't understand what he was asking, but eventually it came to her. She had to entertain Destry, Crump, and Junior to get them to stay. When she told me about it, she looked at me, silent tears running down her cheeks. I asked her where Marshall thought she was, and she told me that she had told him that her mother was sick and that she would spend a few days with her. Upon her return, she was to serve Destry and his boys. She didn't know what to do. I wanted to make things clear to her. "We're not getting back together," I told her. Too much had happened. But I would help her. I just wasn't sure how at the time. We ended up talking for a long time. She was crying and wishing she'd never been there for Marshall. I told her I agreed, but you can't change what's already happened. We talked about happier times and laughed about some things. It was comfortable and friendly. It was probably one of the most open and honest conversations we have ever had. We paused for a moment and I wondered if I should ask the next question, but curiosity took over and I asked her. "Tracy told me about the game of hide and seek. What was it?" I asked with a smile. It seemed like a safe and easy topic to me. She looked down. She was silent for probably 2 whole minutes. I figured she just wasn't going to answer. Finally, in a whisper, in a voice an octave or two higher, childlike, she told me the story. My dad lived with us. He wasn't home a lot. He drove a truck. I wondered what this had to do with my question. I didn't say anything, just listened. When he was at home, he used to get angry a lot. My mom told me not to make him angry. When he played with me, I was so happy. She continued to speak in a little girl's voice. We lived in an old farmhouse on the outskirts of Prairie View. I think I was about 4 years old. It was a big house. He liked to play hide and seek with me. One day I begged him to play with me. He was in a bad mood, but finally said he would play. I hid, and he never came looking for me. I never saw him again. He left us, and my mom blamed me. And that's all she said. After a moment, I asked, I needed to know, why were you naked when we played? She sat like that for a minute or two, and I could see that she was thinking intensely. Finally, she looked me straight in the eye and said, because he liked me so much. Oh my God. I just sat there, speechless, staring at her. That poor, sweet, spoiled little girl. It explained so many things. I wanted to hug her and protect her and tell her everything was going to be okay. But I couldn't. It wouldn't be fair to anyone. At that moment, I saw the reflection of the headlights flicker into the store. Iris was here. On the way home, I called Iris. I needed her help. When Iris came in, Tracy was alarmed. What's she doing here? She asked. Tracy, I said calmly and soothingly. Iris will help. But she's Marshall's niece, she faltered. Tracy, don't worry, Iris said. I hate my uncle. I won't work with him or mom anymore. I'm here to help you, Iris explained. I needed Iris to stay with Tracy while I did a few other things. I didn't want Tracy to be alone. After listening to her story, I realized that we needed to get Tracy out of Central Oregon and that she needed professional help. I had a friend in the valley, a mental health professional, who I would call tomorrow. I had a plan. It was risky. I couldn't let anyone find out about my plans. Well, maybe just one person. Iris put Tracy to bed in the master bedroom and we talked. I explained the whole story to Iris. By the time I was done, she was furious with her uncle. I told her what I needed from her and she agreed. If all went well, Iris would take Tracy to the valley in a day or two. I asked Tracy about her cell phone. She looked for it but said she must have lost it. She did that from time to time, so I wasn't surprised. I searched her car and found it under the driver's seat. I was going to need it. The next morning, while everyone was still up, I had coffee with Preston. I had unwittingly started this conversation with Preston. There are times in life when you have to trust people. This was one of those moments for me. I told him I'd see him tomorrow night. That morning, I called my friend in the valley. I explained what Tracy had been through and asked for his help. He gave me a name. After 3 or 4 more referrals, many hours on the phone, mostly on hold, we found a residential treatment facility for Tracy. It cost some money, but there was no question that it had to be done. And I was paying. We agreed that Iris would take her to the valley the next morning. Iris said she had college friends there and planned to stay with them for a few days. That's good. Taking Tracy's cell phone, I set the trap. An hour later, I got the answer I was hoping for. Mid-afternoon, I loaded up my truck and drove to Preston's, leaving my bright red truck with the fresh KC Custom Carpentry logo right in front of Preston's house. We talked for a while, and then he handed me the keys to his old gray battered Tacoma Ranch truck, a vehicle as conspicuous as a tumbleweed in the desert. I grabbed my duffel bag and shoved it into the Tacoma. With nervous anger, I pulled out of my seat. When I finished my 3/4 mile hike to the base of the bridge, dusk was already descending. I didn't see a soul. I was dressed in all black. I kept checking for cameras, but everything was still too undeveloped. I was safe. I crept up to the ledge under the bridge that Destry had built by the new house on Canyon. Cautiously, I climbed up onto the frame, always keeping to the near side of the frame. The far side was a problem, and it would only get worse from here. My saw cut through the screws and some of the supports shifted a bit. There were some nervous moments, but everything held, just barely. Now the framing on the far side of the bridge was just resting against the 4x6 girders. In high winds, the bridge could have collapsed. I then attached a rope to the near end of the 4x6 girder. I crawled back to the safety of the ledge and looked at my watch. 18:15. I pulled out Tracy's phone and checked the messages. One was from Marshall. On my way, baby, can't wait to see you naked. And then I looked at the previous post. Then at 6:30 at the Canyon House coup. And then the one I'd sent earlier. I studied the way she corresponded with him to mimic the way she wrote to him. Marsh, honey, mom is driving me crazy and I miss you. I was hoping we could play a game at the Canyon House. We can meet there Friday night. I can probably be there between 6:30 and 7 o'clock. Then I deleted the history of the text. It was getting cooler and it was pitch black. There were no lights around, but my eyes were getting used to the darkness, adjusting. A few sounds, but pretty quiet. I grabbed a few rocks just in case. I also grabbed a piece of pressure-treated 2x4 lumber. I was ready to go. Now I was waiting. It didn't take long. I heard a Suburban pull up. There was some old rock song from the 90s playing on the radio in his car. I always hated that kind of music. And then there was silence as he turned off the car. He whistled as he walked across the bridge. There was a slight shift in the section I was working on as he crossed that part, but it held. I saw one light come on in the house as he entered. I thought about this house, but it still wasn't finished. Destry really was a shitty builder. I tied the rope around a small, thick tree on the far side of my ledge. This would give me leverage when I pulled it. Tracy called me, "You're still coming." It was 6:55. I didn't answer. 7:10, "Where the hell are you?" Marshall Pheasant doesn't like to be kept waiting. A few minutes later, the lights go out in the house and I hear the door slam. Showtime. This time he crosses the bridge without whistling. Halfway across to back up, I threw a handful of pebbles on the far side of the bridge. I see him pause and turn at the noise. This distracts his attention, and I manage to remove the slack in the rope so that he doesn't notice the movement. I timed it perfectly. I confidently and firmly pulled the rope, and the 4x6 bridge collapsed into the canyon. Now the long end of the bridge is not supported by anything, and it too is starting to collapse and fall. When the long end of the bridge collapses into the canyon, Marshall amazingly leaps across the void and grabs onto the secure short end of the bridge. He hangs on. "Help! Help!" he yells. Then he tries to get up. Marshall was once a strong man, but now he's heavier and not as strong as he used to be. There is no way he can bring himself to get up. I decide to speed up the process. "Hey, Marshall," I said. "Who is this?" "Kevin?" "Kevin, you have to help." "The bridge has fallen. Help me up," he shouts. "Marshall, do you remember what you said to me last time?" I ask. "Kevin, for God's sake, I'm starting to crawl," he pleads. Adrenaline raged through me, but I felt absolutely no remorse. With my iPhone flashlight, I inspected the ledge to make sure there was no sign of my presence there. I threw a 2x4 down into the canyon. Despite the cool evening, I was covered in sweat. An hour later, I was back at Preston's. I didn't even go inside, but threw my gear in my truck and drove away. The next few days passed without much incident. I talked to Iris, and now Tracy was in a treatment facility called Willows. She would be there for at least 60 days. I was paying, and it wasn't cheap. Preston and I met on Saturday morning and walked around his property for a bit. We talked about life and then moved on to the county court decision and plans for when all of this happens. Finally, back at his house, he told me how on Friday night he and I ordered 2 large pizzas with delivery from Smokey Dean's in town. He gave the driver a $40 tip, just to make sure he remembered us. As the driver was leaving, Preston asked him if they had hit the fender of the red truck out front. Courier and Preston examined it and realized there was no dent. Preston apologized for his accusations. He must remember seeing my truck. As I turned to leave, Preston asked, "So?" I looked him in the eye, nodded quickly, then turned and walked away. We never talked about it again. Monday morning, Angel and I are working at the Reese's construction site on River Ridge. Mid-morning, we hear sirens and a flurry of activity near our construction site. I guess what's going on, but I ignore it. In the evening, it's all over the news. An influential local builder dies in a construction accident. And on it goes. A terrible fall, unknown circumstances, a tragic death. Iris calls, and although she has grown to despise her uncle, he is still her uncle. She says she's going back to Central Oregon. There are a few more calls from mutual acquaintances, and I make appropriate remarks, but for the most part, I ignore all the noise. After all, Angel and I have a house to build. About a week later, in the middle of the day, a new black sedan pulls up to our construction site. 2 men got out of it. One was from CCB, the Builders Council, and the other was from the district attorney's office. They wanted to talk to Angel. Even though they didn't want me there, I didn't leave Angel's side. They were investigating the construction site where Marshall died. They were asking specifically about the bridge. Angel told them he had nothing to do with this construction. He said he even voiced his concerns to Terry Destry, but was told to mind his own business. I guess they didn't believe Angel. I went to get something from my truck. It was a copy of a magazine with a picture of the house Angel and I had built a few years ago, hinging it over a dried-up creek bed. I showed them the article. It was an example of the quality of work Angel had done on a project like this. I explained it to them. The ADA remembered the article. They then asked about Destry, Crump, and Junior. Angel gave them his honest opinion and, frankly, took them calmly. When I had a spare moment, I made my points about their poor quality. I was less diplomatic. They went on to say that it could end with the three being banned from building in Oregon, and there is a possibility that manslaughter charges will be filed. They thanked us and left. Angel and I continued to work successfully on Reese's house. It's late Friday night, I'm working on a saw, and a gray pickup truck with a club cab pulls up to the job site. The three doors open and Terry Destry, Ed Crump, and Junior Messersmith step out. Destry walks in front. "You got a big mouth, Cotton," Destry says as he approaches me, and the other two step on his heels. He looms over me. A quick glance shows that Angel is inside watching what's going on. "I was just telling the truth. Sometimes the truth can hurt," I tell him. I know it's not smart to piss him off, but I hate that bastard. "Well, we've been banned from building in this goddamn state, so we're going back to Texas," he tells me. "Before we go, the boys and I have a little unfinished business with you. I believe you owe me." "I never was able to entertain your wife." He said this, and Krampus laughed. I noticed Angel rounding the corner at the back of the house. The three approached. I'd been in this spot before at Maxine's. Just then I saw Angel throw a 25-foot Stanley Fat Max measuring tape at Junior. It clinked against the hairless back of his head. Junior spins in place, stunned and enraged. Angel, nimble and quick, shortens the distance and strikes Junior's balls with his steel boot. His eyes bulge, his mouth folds into a wordless O, and he falls like a giant redwood tree. A modern-day David and Goliath situation. Angel turns to Crump, and the latter, cackling, runs off, Angel after him. As I watch Angel pounce on Crump, Destry throws the first punch. A brutal overhand right that would have knocked me down if I hadn't reflexively tucked my chin. But it still hurts. I'm stunned, and he tries a combo, left to right. I cover up, but the bastard is fast. A few punches miss. He keeps coming, and I retreat. He thinks because I don't hit back, he's got the advantage. If anyone remembers the Foreman and Alley fight, Rumble in the Jungle, Alley had his own strategy. Let big old George Foreman throw a lot of punches and wear himself out. Ali entered the fight in the last few rounds and defeated an exhausted Foreman. I certainly wasn't comparing myself to Ali, but I started to notice Destry getting tired. Smoking is not good for the lungs. As he continued to throw punches, his arms seemed to droop. So far, I haven't thrown a single punch. Suddenly, sensing his fatigue, I delivered a straight right punch that hit him in the left eye. It stunned him. He raised his arms and I hit him right in the belly. Then two more punches to the head. He tried to grab me in a clinch. I stepped back and kicked him in the balls. Not as good a punch as Angel's in Junior. But that's all it took. He went down in a fetal position. I called the police, but before they got there, Destry had crawled to the truck and made off with Junior. I never saw Crump or the other two assholes again. As we left the construction site, I thanked Angel for saving me from Junior, looked at him and asked, "How would you feel about becoming a partner in the construction business?" He laughed and shook my hand. Epilogue. Pheasant's construction collapsed after everything that happened. Claudia asked me if I wanted to buy it. I told her I didn't want anything to do with that business. "No, thank you. We have changed the name of our business to K and a Custom Carpentry. Things are going well. We have taken on several jobs that were previously Pheasant projects. Tracy's gotten a lot better. She lives in the valley, has a boyfriend. I met him a couple times. His name is Claude Barron. His name is Bear. Big, bearded, quiet guy. He's devoted to Tracy. I know people ask why I'm not angry at Tracy for her betrayal. Having dealt with the trauma of her childhood, I feel sorry for her and protective of her more than anything else. She seems almost like a little sister to me now. County zoning has passed, and aside from the construction business, a lot of my time is spent on that. Preston has become my best friend. And then there's Iris. We're close. We share a lot of the same interests. She does most of the design work for Angel and me. She designs for others and sometimes works hourly on our jobs. It's a bit of an odd relationship because of our history and my history with her family, but we are growing closer. We're taking it slow, but I can't imagine my life without her. And I really want to see her naked. With that comment, I get a pretty big tap on the shoulder. "Oh, I forgot you were here while I was telling this story," I say, and she laughs. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed it, so subscribe to my channel and watch the next video.